Hello and welcome to our archive about the chain rule. Now, you might say, well, what in the world is the chain rule? That's sort of an odd sort of name for a rule. Well, it's because we're going to have to pay attention to a composition of functions when you have a function inside of a function. And so there's sort of linkage that happens, and hence the name the chain rule. And the one in particular that we're going to look at specifically, the chain rule is sort of a more generic description for a bunch of rules, really, that where the chain rule applies. And one specific version of the chain rule we're going to look at is called the general power rule. So you might recall we did the simple power rule where it was x to a power. But now we're going to have not x to a power, but an entire function raised to a power. So first let's take a look at what the chain rule looks like. And I'm going to pay attention more to the formula that is after it says, or equivalently. And it says d dx of f of g of x. So here g of x is the function inside of the function f. That's equal to the derivative of f with g inside of it and g untouched. Notice g stays as is. And then times the derivative of g. So in essence, we're going to take the derivative of the outside function f, leave the inside function alone, and then multiply by the derivative of the inside function g. Okay, so we're always going to be working outside to inside, outside to inside. And we talked about that before when deciding whether to use the product rule first or the quotient rule first that I told you to look at. What's the outermost thing going on? And depending on where your parentheses are, it might be division or it might be multiplication. But we're going to use that same idea. So the general power rule is just a special case of the chain rule. We'll see the chain rule again when we talk about logarithmic functions and when we talk about exponential functions. But for our purposes here, we're going to talk about it when we've got a function raised to a power. Okay? And when we do that, we're going to use the power rule as we know it, where we bring the exponent down to the front, we subtract one from the exponent. Now notice here that the function inside remains the same, and then the chain part comes where we have to multiply by the derivative of the inside function. So a function raised to a power, its derivative is, bring the power down in front, leave the inside function alone, because we haven't finished with the general power rule yet, you have to subtract one from the exponent, and then once you do that, you have to multiply by the derivative of the inside. So we're going to do a couple of examples of applying the general power rule. So let's go to the whiteboard. All right, so our first one is we'd like to differentiate the function f of x equals 3x squared plus 1 to the fourth power. So here we have a function inside of a function. Okay, we have a composition of functions. This is our inside function, the 3x squared plus 1. And then our outside function is the power function. So the function that raises things to the fourth power is our outside function. So you can think of this is really just an extension of the power rule. We're going to take the outside function, the power that's going on the outside, bring it down in front, subtract one, so on and so forth. So let's see it in action to see how this really works. So f prime of x is going to be, now as we said, we work on the outside first. So the outside part is the power rule part. So 4 times 3x squared plus 1 to the, now notice I left the inside alone because I haven't finished what's going on the outside. I haven't finished the derivative of the outside part. I don't want to touch the inside until I finish with the outside. So now, to the third power. Now I've done with the inside, or the outside. So now I'm going to take care of the inside. So here's the chain part. How do I link the derivative using the outside and the inside part? And it's right here. Okay. So this is going to be 4 times 3x squared plus 1 raised to the third times 3x squared, the derivative of 3x squared is 6x. And of course, I want to clean that up, use the commutative property of multiplication. 4 times 6 is 24. I can bring the x out to the front, again, because of the commutative property. And that's the derivative. Okay. Now you might say, well, yeah, okay, great, big deal. Why bother with the chain rule? Well, the only other way to really take the derivative of the original function that we started here, f, is to multiply this all out. Write it out four times, do the distribution, you get a big long polynomial, it would be an eighth degree polynomial, and then you could take the derivative. This allows us to take a shortcut to get to the derivative. We did this basically in two steps, okay, rather than having to do all this algebra way ahead of time to get to where we are. Okay? So again, outside, inside. The inside doesn't get touched until after you've fully completed what's the derivative of the outside function. In this case, our outside function is going to be the power function. Okay. All right, let's try another one. This time we've got the function g of x equals the square root of 2x plus 3. Now, just as when we saw we had a square root of x, we couldn't do anything with it until we converted it to an exponent. And the same thing applies here. I don't have a specific rule for square roots, but I do have a rule for powers. So this is 2x plus 3 all to the 1/2 power. Again, I'm going to point out inside function and outside. And which do we take the derivative of first? The outside function. So the chain rule, we're going to remember that linkage that has to occur. That we work on the derivative of the outside function first. So in that case would be bring the 1/2 down. I have not yet finished with the outside function. So the inside function is left as is. And then I subtract 1 from the exponent. So 1/2 minus 1 would be negative 1/2. Now the chain rule comes into play, times the derivative of the inside. The derivative of 2x plus 3 would be 2. And again, I can clean this up by using the commutative property of multiplication. I can take 1/2 times 2, which is 1, times 2x plus 3 to the negative 1/2. And if we wanted to rewrite this back in radical form and get rid of the negative exponent, it would look like so. Okay, that would be our final answer. Okay, so again, outside, inside, outside, inside. Now, just as when we learned about the product and the quotient rule that you could apply more than one rule at a time, we're going to see how that works with applying both the chain rule and a quotient rule. Okay, so we've got a function here that we're going to call y is equal to 6 minus 5x over x squared minus 1 all to the second power. Okay, so I'm going to notice I've got an outside and I've got an inside function. So again, let's point out this whole entire thing is the inside function. This here is the outside function. So the rule, chain rule says we take the derivative, the outside part first. So that's a power. So 2 times 6 minus 5x over x squared minus 1 raised to the, now notice I left the inside alone again because what? I haven't finished taking the derivative of the outside. 2 minus 1 is to the first power, times the derivative of the inside, derivative of 6 minus 5x over x squared minus 1. So here, I'm going to need to apply the quotient rule to find the derivative of the inside. So let's go ahead and this is 2 times 6 minus 5x over x squared minus 1 times bottom to top. Bottom, the top, derivative of 6 minus 5x is 0 minus 5 times 1, so negative 5 minus top, the bottom. Derivative of x squared minus 1 is 2x, all over bottom squared. This is, I'm going to, let's see, right? This has 2 times 6 minus 5x over x squared minus 1. And then times, let's see what we've got here. We've got negative 5 times x squared, so minus 5x squared. Negative 1 times negative 5 is plus 5. Minus, let's see, 6 times 2 is 12x. And then minus a negative 5x times 2x, so that's plus 10x squared. All over x squared minus 1 squared. So let's see, I've got 2 times 6 minus 5x times, let's see, we've got 10x squared minus 5x squared, so that's 5x squared minus 12x plus 5 from the other numerator, all over, now we're multiplying, so remember when you multiply fractions, you multiply across the numerators, multiply across the denominators, so I've got an x squared minus 1 times 2 factors of x squared minus 1, that leaves 3 factors of x squared minus 1. Okay. And this isn't going to be factorable because b squared minus 4ac, the discriminant, b squared is 144 minus 4 times ac, 4 times 5 times 5, so that's 100. So 44 square root, 44 is not a, let me do my work here. Let's see, 12 squared minus 4 times 5 times 5, right? The discriminant b squared minus 4ac. This is 144 minus 100, 44. So the square root of 44 would be 2 times square root 11. It's not a whole number, right? That would be the part under the radical of the quadratic formula. And if you don't get a whole number, then that means this is not factorable over the integers. So so that's not factorable over the integers. And so that would be our final answer. So that's it with the chain rule. Just remember, outside, inside, and you don't take the derivative of the inside until you've completely finished the outside. Okay? Make sure you subtract the 1, then you link the chain by taking the derivative of the inside afterwards.